Why don't we begin with a word of prayer? Oh, gracious Father in heaven, we are so blessed to call thee our Father, so blessed for the life that thou hast given unto us today and granted us in thy grace. And Father, we are thankful also, I know myself, for the songs of the birds that are such a pleasant alarm in the morning. We thank thee for thy loving kindness in every good and perfect gift, in every blessing that cometh down from above. We thank thee for them, and for the message that thou hast prepared for us today. And Father, I pray that thou wilt anoint my lips, that I may speak the truth, that the words that I may speak will not be mine own, but that they will be filled with thy Spirit, that they may be pure and true and holy, those things that will be elevating and uplifting, that will exalt Jesus and lift him up, that all men may be drawn unto him. And I pray, Father, that thy name be glorified and exalted in all things through thy Son, Jesus. For we ask this in his name. Amen. Amen. Did anyone remember where we left off in our last talk? Perilous times. You remember Sister White told us, because of what had transpired in 1888, that perilous times were upon us. Perilous times were upon us. And this morning we're going to look at what the Bible says about perilous times. And the subtitle for the message today is Apparent Opposites. Because one of the perils that we face as Christians is just that, apparent opposites. What do I mean? We shall see. But first, turn with me to our key text. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. Now, we could read the verses that follow also, because Paul adds much to this list to define the perils of the last days and why they're perilous. But notice he says, this know also. This is knowledge that we should have in addition. God wants us to know this also. Not only the gospel is important to know, but something else is important to know. And that is that in the last days, he says, perilous times shall come. It's true that the Apostle Paul believed that he lived in the last days. But I believe he was speaking of a time distant to his own. Paul recognized even in his own day the mystery of iniquity was working. But it was just that. It was working. It had not come to fruition. It had not reached its zenith. It would take some time before he who would let, and the man of sin would be revealed. It would take some time. And I believe Paul understood that, though he didn't perhaps understand the length of time that it would take. But we do. We today, we can look back and see all these things. But we know that the peril of the last times particularly pertains to us today. We of all people and all times face the most severe of perils. We're surrounded on every hand with danger. 100 years ago, it couldn't be said like it can be today, the dangers that we face. Not only physical dangers in our environment, the food we eat, but we have spiritual peril to a degree that no other time has ever seen. We're bombarded with it. When we drive down the road, when we turn on the radio, if you happen to have a television, if that is turned on, if you read a book, if you peruse the shelves at your shopping, when you go to the grocery store, everything that you see is bombarding you with evil. We live in perilous times, beloved. In Matthew chapter 8 and verse 28, I want us to turn there for a moment, and then I'll tell you why once we read the verse. Matthew 8, verse 28. Now, it might seem as though this verse has no context, but I assure you it does. It says, "And when he," that is Jesus, "was come to the other side, into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils, coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way." What does this have to do with perilous times? Well, certainly Jesus was in peril, it would seem. His disciples certainly thought they were in peril because they fled for their lives, until they looked back and saw that Jesus hadn't fled with them. But what does this have to do with our time? This.
Scared.
That the word perilous that is used in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, is only used two times in the Bible. The other time, well, you guessed it, Matthew 8, 28. And it's translated exceeding fierce. It's the definition of those possessed men. Just how perilous are the times? Exceeding fierce. Exceeding fierce, beloved. We face no ordinary peril. Hope you're still in Matthew. Chapter 24, verse 11. Matthew 24, verse 11. One of the reasons why we face peril today. Jesus says this, "And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive some." A few. Not just a remnant. What does it say? Many. We might even say most. Though the Word of God just says many. We don't know how many that is, but we know it's many. We could assume from that it's the majority. The majority will be deceived. And why? By whom? What does it say? Many good prophets, many sincere prophets.
False
prophets. Now, do you suppose these false prophets are prophets of Baal that go around saying, "I'm a prophet of Baal, listen to me"? No. Or do you suppose that they call themselves Christian? Perhaps even Seventh-day Adventist? How else are they going to deceive, beloved?
Have a form of godliness, no power.
Can you deceive a sheep? Can a wolf deceive a sheep unless it's clothed in sheep's clothing? No. You see, deception requires that you have a semblance of sanctity. That's what made the continual, or daily as it's translated, become the continual abomination. You see, the pagan form of Rome, which was the continual, became cloaked in Christianity at the time of Constantine and became known as the abomination of desolation. Pagan Rome was a desolating power, but it wasn't abomination so much in God's sight. Until it became nominally Christian. Then it was an abomination of desolation. And today that abomination continues. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, we read this. "But there were false prophets also among the people," speaking of the time past, of the Hebrew people, the Israelites. There were false prophets among them. And if you read in the books of Kings and Chronicles, you see this is very true. Israel was filled full of false prophets. In fact, if you read in 1 Kings chapter 18, you find that there were hundreds of them. And Elisha considered himself the only prophet of the Lord. He was stood one among hundreds, maybe even thousands. There were some, how many, 500 or more that just sat at Jezebel's table. That doesn't include the others that weren't privileged enough to sit at her table. So we know that what Peter says is true. There were false prophets among the people. But notice what he draws from this fact. Even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. One of the dangers we face, false prophets. But as I mentioned, a prophet isn't dangerous unless he looks friendly, unless he looks sincere and professes sincerity and the truth to preach the Bible and the Bible only. It's no deception. But not only are there false prophets that we have to worry about, but Peter likens the false prophets in the time of old to present-day teachers among us. Not just prophets, those who claim the ability to foresee and foretell the future, but those who teach and preach the Word of God. So it's not just, we could say literally, prophets that we have to worry about, but Peter uses a correlation to liken teachers today to the prophets of old. And going back to 1 Timothy, actually not going back to it, going to 1 Timothy. Let's note what is said in chapter 4, verse 1. The Apostle Paul says, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly." What does it mean when it says expressly?
Clearly.
It means that it can't be taken this way or this way. It's explicit. There's no misunderstanding here. The Spirit speaketh expressly that there should be what? In the latter times, some should what?
Depart.
We would, another term for that would be?
Apostasy.
Some would depart from the truth, from the faith. We call that apostasy. Giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Now we know that these verses, immediately following, the context tells us that this specifically refers to the power of Rome, papal Rome, in specific, because of the details. But it also applies to those that follow after, her daughters, and those who have the spirit of the papacy, the spirit of Antichrist. It would include all such, not just the mother of this, but those who would follow in her spirit. And the spirit is expressed in this, that there was going to be an apostasy. And it says that this apostasy would include two things. Well, one thing, really, resulting from some conditions. The thing that it would result in was a departure from what?
The faith.
Now, the little word the is important there. It doesn't say a departure from faith, which we could just take in a general sense, some people losing their faith. But here it says the faith.
Definite article.
That's right. The definite article tells us that it's a particular faith, a definite faith. And that faith is the faith which had been delivered to the disciples, that which had been delivered to the apostles, and that which the apostles themselves preached and taught, that which was handed down from century to century faithfully from the apostles to the Waldensians, from the Waldensians to the Reformers. From the Reformers was handed down to our pioneers, and from our pioneers was faithfully handed to us. But you see, there would be a departure from that faith, which the apostle says. Not only has Catholicism departed from the faith, but all of her daughters, too, are in apostasy. There is a departure from the faith of the Word of God, from the faith that has been handed down to us. In this same book, chapter 1, verse 3. I want us to take note of a couple of things here. Now, I've chosen as my theme text from the second epistle to Timothy. And the letters to Timothy and Titus are important. I'm using them because of their relation to the topic that we're discussing today, perilous times. Paul was living in the beginning of these perilous times, and he knew that in his departure, there were going to have to be men who would take up his work, men who would have the same love and dedication to the church to seek to purify it, to keep out the evil. They would have to be men of strong conviction, men of noble character, men who are willing to stand for the right, though the heavens should fall. And Paul sought to raise up just such men, and two of them were Timothy and Titus. And Timothy, we read here in chapter 1, verse 3, Paul says that he besought him. He pleaded with him to abide still at Ephesus. Now, why did he have to plead with Timothy? Obviously, Timothy wanted to be with Paul, didn't he, in his travels. But Paul said, no, there's a greater need for you to remain at Ephesus. Why? Let's note why. He says, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. What was going on in Ephesus? Some were teaching another gospel, beloved. Some were teaching to bring in another faith. They were teaching other than that which the Apostle Paul had taught, which was what Jesus himself had taught. And Paul left Timothy there because Timothy had been associated with Paul almost from the very beginning. And he was familiar with Paul's teaching more perhaps than anyone else. And he was prepared to meet these other doctrines from the Word of God and by the power of the Spirit of God. Timothy was prepared. He had been anointed and had the hands of the presbytery laid upon him. Timothy was called to this work. And so Paul felt secure that he could leave him there to accomplish that work, even though it meant being separated from him in his travels. But Timothy was to meet a danger, a peril that was entering in. False teachers, false prophets were coming in, teaching other doctrine. And it says other doctrine. And you'll note there, if you have a concordance, that it comes from a verb that is a combination of two words. One is the verb form, the didaskalo, which means to teach. But it's preceded by a little word that is here translated other. We say in English heteros. Heteros. And it's heterodidaskalo, or in other words, another teaching. And the word hetero is interesting because it's one of two Greek words that mean other. In English, we just have one word that has both the meanings. But in Greek, you had a separate word for each meaning. If I said, I want another presenter, a presenter which is another of the same, I would say allos in Greek. But if I wanted something other than this presenter, something different, not the same, I would say hetero. You see, I'm a male. My wife is female. We call that heterosexual, the other sex. Not the same. She's not a male. She's a female. So we call it heterosexual. So you see the significance. They were teaching another doctrine. It was not the same. It was different. It was a variant from the truth. It was diverging from the truth, departing from it. But Timothy was not alone in this. If we turn to Titus, I want us to take close note of this. In the opening words to Titus, we read this too. Verses 1 first, and then let's read verse 5. Paul says, Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. Now let's notice verse 5. For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee. The danger here in Crete was that Crete had no one to lead it, no one to guide it. It didn't have organization. It was simply a mass of believers, but they weren't organized. They didn't have those who were learned, those who were men of distinction and noble character, set up as and ordained as elders to reside over that church, to rear it up in righteousness. So Paul left Titus there to accomplish that work, to put things in order that were in disorder. Notice verse 1. Let's go back to verse 1. Paul says that he's a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ. What's the next phrase?
According
to the faith. Why did he qualify himself thus? Do you know what the word according means? It comes from the Greek preposition kata, which means in harmony with or in line with. Paul called himself an apostle of Jesus Christ in harmony with what? The faith. In harmony with the faith of God's elect. He was in harmony with his brethren, doctrinally. And Paul qualifies himself that he was an apostle in harmony with the faith that had been delivered by Christ to his apostles. Why would he need to do this if there weren't others who were not in harmony, not according to the faith? Continuing, it says, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. And that word after is from the same Greek preposition kata, according. An acknowledging of the truth which is in harmony with what?
Godliness.
And godliness, beloved, is none other than Jesus. It's in harmony with the life, teaching, and practice of Jesus. Paul was an apostle in harmony with the acknowledging of the truth as it is in Christ Jesus. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 9, we're just getting through with our introduction here. Matthew 15, verse 9, Jesus says, but in vain they do what?
Worship me,
teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Now Jesus said they were worshiping him. So they must have been those who proclaimed themselves to be Christians or believers. Correct? Me, we might say, not only Jesus himself personally, but God. These people claimed to be worshipers of God. Did they not? Those that Jesus was addressing? Didn't they? Who were they? No one knows? Who was Jesus addressing? The lawyers, the scribes, the Pharisees, the leaders of Israel. He said these men claimed to worship God, and they did. But how were they worshiping God? What does Jesus say? In vain. Why? Why was their worship vain? Jesus says because they were teaching for doctrines, what? The commandments of men. Why was their worship empty and vain? Not because it didn't have truth, but because with that truth was mingled in the teachings of men. They taught as doctrine, as their teaching, the substance of what they taught were the commandments of men. And by commandments of men, we wouldn't say it was something as itself apart from the Word of God. But we would say in addition to. For most of the writings of the Hebrews, rabbinical, are not so much set apart from the Word of God, but they are an addition to it. They're a commentary upon it. And this takes the place of the Word of God itself. What Rabbi so-and-so says about the Word of God became more important to them than what the Word of God itself said. And beloved, that is the same danger we face today. There are those who are taking what men say about the Word of God as greater than what the Bible itself says. Their worship, beloved, is vain. The Bible tells us about a system known as Babylon the Great. Yesterday we opened up in our opening text with Revelation chapter, anyone remember? Chapter 12, very good. Someone's got a good memory. Today we're going to look at Revelation chapter 17, where Babylon the Great is mentioned. There's something significant about this system that I want us to note. Not so much about the woman itself, but in Revelation chapter 17, an angel is sent to John to give him a vision of this system. And he says that an angel came to him, verse 1, going back here, says unto him, "Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that," what? "Sitteth upon many waters." Notice this. He's going to show the judgment of this whore. Now let's go down to verse 3. I did it in the reverse order. In verse 3 it says, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns." Now, didn't something pop up in your mind when I read verse 3? Maybe it didn't. Maybe we're so conditioned that it didn't. But it should. In verse 1, it says that this whore sitteth where?
Many waters.
Upon many waters. Then we go to verse 3, and where's she sitting? Upon many waters?
On a beast.
Oh, a beast. Didn't that strike you as odd? It says he's going to show... The angel says he's going to show John the judgment of this whore that sitteth upon many waters. And shouldn't we expect when he sees her that she would be sitting on waters? Isn't that logical? Certainly. But when we see her, where is she seated? Upon a beast with 7 heads and 10 horns. Interesting. But God does not leave us confounded, because in verse 15 he explains it all. He says, "And he saith unto me," the angel, "the waters which thou sawest where the whore sitteth are" what? "And nations and tongues." That's right. So you see, he explains it. The waters, of course, represent the people. And the beast, likewise, represents what? Nation. A nation is filled or made up of what?
People.
Multitudes, nations, and tongues. Rome was a conglomerate, just as the United States is today, made up of people from all over, speaking all different tongues, of all different nationalities, multitudes of them. That's what makes up a kingdom. And you see, that which this woman called Babylon is sitting is upon what?
Many waters.
Many waters. A beast. One symbol interpreting another. This is how the Bible defines itself. in prophecy. But notice how many waters?
Many.
Many waters. She has a wide influence. We would say an influence over all, with the exclusion, of course, of the elect. Those who, for the grace of God, are not deceived. The whole world goeth after this woman. She sits on the whole world, so to speak. And we see this in another vision or dream given to an interesting man by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. In Daniel chapter 2, we read of this. We're going to actually, in verse 1, we read that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream and that he was troubled by this dream. And so troubled, in fact, that he called for all the wise men of his kingdom to tell him what he dreamed, because he couldn't for the life of him remember it. But he knew it was significant. So he needed to know what he had dreamt and what its meaning was. So he called the wise men to tell him this, but they could not. But there was one who could. And that one was God. And that God had a prophet in Babylon. And that prophet says this, verse 29, in speaking to the king. He says, "As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed, what should come to pass hereafter. And he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass." Daniel tells the king not only the significance of the vision, what he saw, but he tells him even what was going on in his mind when he went to bed that night. God wanted to convince Nebuchadnezzar that what he was hearing was the word of God. And so he put into Daniel's mouth these words. Who but Nebuchadnezzar would know what was going on in his mind that night when he lay upon his bed, thinking about the future of his kingdom, Babylon? And God showed him the future of that kingdom. And in that dream, he represented that kingdom, didn't he? And how did he represent it? Let's look. Verse 31. "Thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible." And what was its form? What was this an image of?
Beast.
A beast?
Man.
No, it wasn't a beast. It had heads, breast and arms, legs and feet. It was the image of a man. How was Babylon here represented to King Nebuchadnezzar? His kingdom? By the image of a man. Because that's what it is. That's what Babylon is. It's the kingdom of men. It's made up of men. It's ruled by men who dictate to other men what they will do. It's the kingdom of men, not the kingdom of God. It's the kingdom of men. And it's represented as a man. That's what Babylon is. It's the worship of man. Because that was an idol which Nebuchadnezzar saw. And he was so impressed by it, he went out and built his own, made his own of pure gold. This one, all gold. He didn't want the other metals. He just wanted it all to be Babylon. But it was an idol, just as he'd seen. An idol of man. The devil's devices. You see, Babylon is Satan's most successful tool here on earth in deceiving the masses. And the devil has devices. In Ephesians chapter 6, I want us to take note of something that the Apostle Paul warned them of. In his parting words, do you remember where the Apostle Paul, just as a little side note, where did the Apostle Paul leave Timothy?
Ephesus.
Ephesus, that's right. Interesting. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11, the Apostle Paul says this, "Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now there it doesn't say some of the wiles, or many of the wiles, or most of the wiles. It says the wiles, which would be inclusive of all of them, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Do you know what that word wiles means?
Schemes.
What was that?
Schemes.
Schemes, okay. Another word?
Deception.
Deceptions.
Cunning arts.
Cunning arts. Do you know what the original word is? You might be shocked. It's the Greek word methodeia.
Methods.
That's right. Apostle Paul said, put on the whole armor of God that you can stand against his what? His methods. God wants us to be able to stand against Satan's methods, his devices, the devil's devices, his tactics, because he is a general and he's waging a war. And he's to a large degree very successful in that war because of his devices that are successful. And if those of you who are familiar with sports, those of you who might have been associated with them before you became Christian, you know how important tactics are. You play to win. Tactics are everything in sports. And Satan knows that. He's playing to win. And he has methods that are proven. And the theme is in sports, if it works, keep doing it. Keep doing it. And why change? Why should Satan need to change his methods if they work? Right? The Apostle Peter tells us likewise. Another familiar text. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. He tells us this. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a what?
Roaring
lion walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Why did he say that? Why would he liken Satan to a roaring lion?
When he roars, he knows he has you.
Okay. Why? Anyone familiar here with lions? How do lions hunt?
Quietly.
Well, who hunts, I should say?
Lioness.
The lioness, that's right. You see, the tactic is this. The male lion will go out and search out a group of prey. Mm-hmm. When he comes back, he alerts the females to where those prey are, and they go lie wait in ambush. Then he struts his stuff and he goes out and he makes a big show of himself so that these animals see him. Mm-hmm. And as soon as they see him, he lets out this roar. Mm-hmm. And they say, oh my, a lion. And they run right into the trap. Mm-hmm. A roaring lion. You see, Satan's devices, mm-hmm. beloved. He has tactics. He alerts us to an apparent danger. He says, don't look to men. Right? He's a roaring lion. He's telling us something. Don't look to men. Have you ever heard someone say that to you? Is it true? Should we not look to men? But you see, the danger of the perilous times in which we live are that there are apparent opposites. Apparent opposites. That's true. And he might even quote to you Psalm 146, verse 3. I invite you to read it with me real quickly. Psalm 146, verse 3. It's a psalm that we're familiar with. It says, put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. And he might even tell you and quote to you Hebrews 12, verse 2. And say, look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus. Now, why would the devil tell you that? Because he's using one of his devices, beloved. He only gives you a part of the truth. He withholds some truth from you. Don't look to men, he tells you. And you'll say, because there's no help in them. Look to Jesus. Look only to Jesus. Sounds good, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. It is good. But it's only part of the truth. Sister White tells us in the Review and Herald, August 23rd, 1881, this: ministers and people must learn to look to men less and to God more. Do you see anything significant about that quote, different from what was on the previous slide? Is Sister White here telling us not to look to men? No. It's qualified, isn't it? She says, look to men how?
Less.
She does not say, do not look to men, because that would be an extreme, which is not in harmony with the Word of God. She says, look to men less and to God more. That is in balance. That is a balanced statement, because it's an inspired statement. It tells us that we ought to be looking to God more, but it doesn't say that we should not be looking to men. We should look to them less. God should be the one that we're looking to more. Again, she says this: the people of God have educated themselves in such a way that they have come to look to those in positions of trust as guardians of truth, their leaders, their pastors, their teachers, and have placed men where God should be. You see, it's not that we shouldn't be looking to men, but we have done something that's wrong. We have taken those men and put them where God should be. We're looking to them in the place of God. That's what Babylon is. Putting man in the place of God. And that's precisely what they were doing. She says this: men must not be educated to look to men as to God. Again, qualified. It doesn't say that we should not look to men, but we should not look to them as God, to be the infallible interpreters of His Word. Because that is God's prerogative, beloved, not ours. My words are to be taken with a grain of salt, and taken only as they harmonize with the Word of God. While it is necessary that there be a counseling together, see how she's qualifying? We counsel together as men. It is necessary that there be a counseling together and a unity of action among the laborers. One man's mind and one man's judgment must not be the controlling power. That is God's prerogative. Men are not to control the work. They are not to be the ones making the ultimate decision. There needs to be counseling. We need to come together, make plans, but those plans need to be laid before the feet of Jesus. And He is to decide. But we must come together, study and pray and plan. You see, there is another side, another danger. Taking us back to what we looked at yesterday, the message of 1888, there were two sides to this apparent controversy in 1888, both expressing apparent opposites, another one of Satan's tactics. And why he was so successful in 1888? Because he was using the tactic apparent opposites. It appeared as though what one side was preaching was opposed to what the other side was preaching and teaching in the doctrinal issue. I'm referring exclusively to the doctrine of the law in Galatians, which was the major issue. There appeared to be two opposing sides, but there were only appearances. Because the opposite, they were really opposite extremes, both error. One error taught men to be exclusively dependent upon other men, led to men looking to the leading figures in Adventism for the guidance and direction and judgment and decisions to be made in the church. They become followers of men, the one extreme. And the other extreme was that the danger of, which is the opposite, that we say, oh no, we can't look to men, we can't trust men, they're all evil and wicked. We can only trust God and God alone. But what is that really teaching? It's teaching every man to do that which is right in his own eyes. It's teaching us to look to self, to become self-sufficient, self-trusting. That was the opposite danger, and that's the opposite error that was being taught. You see, the other side in 1888 had learned to look away from men, to become distrustful of men, but they were becoming more trustful of their own judgment than the judgment of the leading men. They were becoming trustful of themselves and of their own opinions, and not really trusting in the Lord. They were following their own inclinations in many cases because of their self-reliance, because they had looked away from men, looked away from the leading which God had been guiding the church all the way along, the source of His guidance, which was through men. You see, there's a balance, and Satan has both extremes covered. There's a middle ground, or a balancing point, that most people are not aware of, that Satan wants to obscure and keep us from being aware of, beloved. You see, there we have two extremes, opposed to each other as far as opposites can be. Of course, I could continue that line on for infinity, and it would still express the same point. But you have two opposites, two extremes. The one extreme, distrust of other men. You notice that word other I put in there and emphasized, because that's really what it amounts to. We have a distrust of other men. But then you have the other extreme, self-trust. They appear to be total opposites, but in reality, they're the same. You see, in order to balance a line like this, you need the middle ground. You need something right in the center to balance it out, in the middle. And often, with these types of deceptions that Satan lays, the truth is right in the middle, where nobody's looking. But that's where the balancing point is. And the balancing point for it all is self-distrust. You see, God wants us to be distrustful of self. We should value the opinion of those who are learned and have experience higher than we value our own. In fact, we should value the opinions of others more than we value our own. That's what the Bible tells us. We ought to be more concerned of the things of others than we are of our own selves. Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 2. We need to learn self-distrust. That's where the safe ground is, to learn to distrust our own opinion and learn to trust God above all and His Word above all, but also to look to the wisdom and counsel of those who have experience and knowledge, those who are godly among us, and trust that. Seek them out. Get their counsel and advice. Learn to distrust self and gain the multitude of counselors where there's safety. Sister White says in Christ's Object Lessons this: the prayer of the publican was heard, speaking of the parable which Christ told about the Pharisee and the publican. The prayer of the publican was heard because it showed dependence reaching forth to lay hold upon omnipotence. What was reaching forth to lay hold upon omnipotence? What's that word?
Dependence.
Dependence. Who's dependent, beloved? Someone who trusts themselves, or someone who distrusts themselves? That's right. Do children trust themselves when they're little? Who do they look to? Are they dependent or independent?
Dependent.
In most cases, they are dependent because they distrust themselves. They trust their parents. The publican's prayer was heard because he was self-distrusting. He showed dependence. Self to the publican appeared nothing but shame. He realized what self was, and he was distrustful of it. He didn't totally shut it away, but he was distrustful of it. Thus, it must be seen by all who seek God, by faith. And she qualifies this statement. Notice how. Faith that renounces what? All self-trust. That's real faith. The needy suppliant is to lay hold upon infinite power. By faith, this faith, the faith of one who realizes his own condition, that he can't trust his own thoughts solely. He must get counsel, he must get wisdom, first of all from the Word of God and inspiration, and secondly from those among his brethren who are wise and learned and have experience, those who are godly. He will seek their counsel and get that wisdom because he distrusts himself. He wants to base his actions and his belief upon the multitude of counselors. Upon precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little, because he knows therein is safety. Therein he can trust. Satan might be able to fool you in one instance in 100, but the more evidences you have, the better you are. You go to a doctor and he says, you've got terminal cancer. You say, okay, and you go home and you get ready to die, right? No. You say, I'm going to go get a second opinion. And you go to that doctor and he says, oh, you've got terminal cancer. And you say, okay, doc, I'm going to get a third opinion. And you go to as many doctors as you can. You get their opinions. And you base your decision upon the multitude of counselors. You use wisdom, beloved. You don't just take the advice of one. You get a second opinion. She says here in the book Education, the reason why so many fall into despair is for this very reason. They have not learned self-distrust. She says this, for them all, Peter's experience had a lesson. That is, Peter's hard experience in Gethsemane, when he learned his own condition, when he denied Jesus. This experience had a lesson. What was it? She says, to self-trust. Trial is what?
Defeat.
Peter trusted himself. He was trusting to himself. And that's what led to his fall. He felt defeated. And he realized his own condition. And it led him not to trust himself so much, but to learn to trust others, especially Jesus. You see, he had doubted Jesus' words before, when Jesus said that thou wilt deny me thrice before the cock crows twice. He didn't believe Jesus, didn't take him at his word. But he had learned to distrust himself and to trust Jesus. And he had to learn it the hard way, beloved, and so can we. If we haven't learned it yet, we can still learn that lesson as Peter did. We don't have to make the mistake that Peter did. We can learn it today if we will. In Luke chapter 6, verse 26, Jesus says this, woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. To whom? The false prophets. Why? What's so bad about speaking well of someone? Shouldn't we speak well of others? Certainly we would. We should. But that's not the connotation of this verse. What's another synonym for to speak well of?
Praise.
Flattery,
that's right. You know, the Bible talks about giving gifts. You said, the Bible says that receiving gifts or taking a gift is bad. Well, why? Well, the word gift is used in the sense of bribe in that instance. We ought not to take gifts. We ought not to take bribes. And when men speak well of you, when they flatter you, watch out, because they're setting a trap for you. They're laying a trap for your feet, just like they did for the false prophets of old. And Jesus is warning them, woe unto you, he says, when all men shall speak well of you, when they flatter you, know that they've laid a snare for your feet, just like they did for those poor old false prophets. They flattered them, making them think so much of themselves, they set them up on the pedestals. The false prophets didn't do it. The people did. And so are we today. We're putting them up, beloved. And we ought not to be doing it. 1 Corinthians 8:2. Might not even need to quote this one or read it. Hopefully we know it. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 2. The Apostle Paul says, if any man think that he knoweth anything, what does he know?
Nothing
as he ought to know it. You see, Satan leaves this bit out. And this is what is all about self-trust. Those who think they know something, when in reality we know nothing as we ought to know it. We ought to remain humble of our own opinion, distrustful of our own opinion, realizing that we do not know it yet as we ought to know it. There are many things that we do not. And if we think we know it, then in reality we know nothing. We need to realize the value of our own opinion. The value of my opinion is only valued based upon the conglomerate. I don't value it myself, but it's based upon everyone else. You see, I don't set the value of gold, everyone else does. It's not what I think gold should be, but it's what everyone else has set that price to be. That's what sets the value of something. If we think we know something, in reality, we're trying to set the value of our own opinion, but we can't do that. Others set that value. And that's why God has a system that is balanced, beloved. In Acts chapter 15, we have an example of this. The very first instance when division comes into the church, there's a controversy. They're about to be divided over an issue that was seemingly unimportant. But to them, it was everything. And it became a divisive issue about circumcision. Because circumcision was a means of entrance into the religion of the Jews. And the Christians still considered themselves Jews. Because most of them were Jews at that time. And they still considered themselves Jews. So this was a major controversy. And it was so much so that it was causing division between the Gentile Christians and the Jewish Christians. And how was it solved? They just said, I don't need to know what anyone else says. I'm just going to go by what the Spirit tells me. Is that how it was decided?
They had a council.
They had a council, that's right. What is it required for a council?
Other people.
More than one. In fact, there should be many, shouldn't there? And there were. There were representatives from all the churches came to this council. And that was how the decision was made. If you read Acts chapter 15, you will see how God answered the division in His own prescribed method. Was counsel taken of God? Certainly it was. Counsel was also taken of men. The subject was discussed, but God made the decision, and it was made through two individuals. Primarily through the influence of Peter's speech in referring to how God had led him. And the decision was made by James as the voice for everyone. And everyone subscribed to it. Not all wholly. But James made the decision. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 17, the Apostle Paul says, brethren, be followers together of what?
Of me.
Thank you. Sure, you give me a bit more time to turn there. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which what? Walk so as ye have us apostles for an example. Mark them. Note them. Why? Paul says, be a follower together of me, and mark those also that follow our example. Why? Why should we mark them? Why? So we can take counsel of them. So we can look to them, receive their wisdom and advice, just as they would from the Apostle Paul. Paul says, follow me. And why should we follow men, beloved? Paul is here calling us to follow him. Together with of me, he says. Why should we follow you, Paul? Because Paul was a follower of who?
Christ.
That's right. There was a condition, a qualification upon Paul's calling them to follow him. but that he himself was a follower of Jesus Christ. Sister White says, the council which decided this case, speaking of Acts chapter 15, was composed of apostles and teachers who had been prominent in raising up the Jewish and Gentile Christian churches, which chose with chosen delegates from various places. Elders from Jerusalem and deputies from Antioch were present, and the most influential churches were represented. The council moved in accordance, remember that word accordance means? In harmony with the dictates of enlightened judgment and with the dignity of a church established by the divine will. As a result of their deliberations, they all saw that God himself had answered the question at issue by bestowing upon the Gentiles the Holy Ghost, and they realized that it was their part to follow the guidance of the Spirit. The entire body of Christians was not called to vote upon the question. The apostles and elders, men of influence and judgment, framed and issued the decree, which was thereupon generally accepted by the Christian churches. Not all, however, were pleased with the decision. There was a faction of ambitious and self-confident, or what we else, how else could we put it? Self-trusting. That's right. Self-trusting brethren or self-confident brethren who disagreed with it. They indulged in much murmuring and fault-finding, proposing new plans and seeking to pull down the work of the men whom God had ordained to teach the gospel message. What were they doing? Undermining the very work which God had ordained to be done. From the first, the church has had such obstacles to meet, but she didn't stop there, did she? And ever will have to the close of time. We still have it today.
Amen.
Same thing is going on, beloved. And until we wake up to it, as I said yesterday, we are the dupes of the devil. Do you want to be a devil's dupe? I don't. And neither does God want us to be. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, the Apostle John tells us to try the spirits. There are many spirits gone out into this world, many false prophets, and we're to try them, but how are we to try them? Apostle John does not tell us how in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, explicitly. In Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20, we are told what? That's right. How do we try the words of others, especially of those who claim to be teachers and preachers? To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not, what? According to this word, it is because there's some light in them.
No light.
No light. That's right. You see, a glass 99.99% water with 0.01% strychnine is what?
Poison.
It's all bad. It's not 99.99 good. It's all bad. Jesus said, if they speak not in accordance with this, all of it, not some of it, all of it, it's because there is no light in them. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 3 through 5. We're wrapping up. It says, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine, notice, which is according to godliness, he is what? Proud, knowing what? Nothing. And we could go on and finish reading. Paul describes what the result is of this. Those who consent not to the words of Jesus, to the words of the Bible, the words of inspiration, Paul defines them as proud and knowing nothing. And in reality, that's how we are, beloved. If we do not believe what God has stated, if we do not take God at His word, we really know nothing. Beloved, there is a balance. And I want us to see that balance. I want us to see where 1888 failed and why it failed. Because until we see where it failed, we're going to continue to fail. Just as they did. We're going to continue to repeat this cycle until God raises up someone else who will see it and will change. And He will lay us aside. Do you want to be laid aside?
No.
I don't. I want to understand why 1888 did not usher in what it was supposed to. I want to understand what caused that failure. And was it a complete failure? No, it wasn't. No, it wasn't. Because we still have the writings which came about because of it, which contain the precious gems of truth which God wanted to reveal, that which God wanted to bring out, which was Jesus. He wanted to bring us back to Jesus, to point us back to Him, to get to look to Him, to trust Him and not man. Not to say that we shouldn't look to men, but we should look to God more than men. That was what 1888 was all about. But Satan was determined to turn our vision away from Jesus, determined to foil God's purpose in getting people to look to Christ in the most holy place. And I believe this is how he did it. Now these are my thoughts. What you've heard today are my conclusions. And I pray that you will search it out and study it for yourself. See if what I'm saying is true. If it's not, throw it to the trash heap. But if it is, beloved, then we have a duty. We have a duty, an individual duty, to see that we do not repeat what happened in 1888. What led both these sides to fail. These men who had a precious message to give to the people. What led to their failure, to eventual apostasy? What led them to their course? And what led these men to so strenuously refuse to accept the message that God had given to His people? What led them to resist it with all their might when they should have embraced it? What brought all that about? Because it did not have to happen. They were both sincere. They were sincere on both sides. They both were Christians. They both loved the truth, but they had a common problem, and that was self-trust. They were the apparent opposites, but in reality, it was the same disease on both sides. And God wants us to learn that lesson today. And we can, beloved. May God help us. Let's close with a word of prayer. O gracious Father in heaven, as I bow before Thee, I realize the nature of my own heart. I know, Father, that through sin it hath been corrupted, and my judgment too, that I cannot trust it. And Father, I want not to trust mine own, but I want to trust Thee. I want to take Thee at Thy word. I want to cherish Thy word. Have it be my privy counselor. I want Thy Holy Spirit too, Father, to guide and direct me in accordance with that word. And I pray, Father, on behalf of all these my brethren who are bowed before Thee, for I believe it is their same desire to follow Thee with all of their heart, to seek Thee, and not to trust themselves, not to make the same mistakes that our fathers have made time and time again, but to learn from their mistakes, that we fall not into that same error. Oh, bless us, Father. Bless us that we may love Thee and look to Thee more, but not that we should turn our eyes away from men, those that Thou hast raised up to guide and direct Thy work here upon earth. Let us learn Thy system, and let us follow it with all of our heart, that Thy work may be accomplished, that Thy Son may come and take us all to heaven and reunite us all, where there will be peace and harmony, joy, and everything that is good that our hearts desire forevermore. For this we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.